Well, it's good to see that we are still moving on and enjoying the Word and the Spirit of God. I'd like to just call our attention to something over there in the book of John. It says there in the 8th chapter that the Pharisees had brought a certain woman to the Lord Jesus who was taken in the act of adultery. So this is a woman that, according to the Mosaic law, should be stoned to death. And they grabbed her in the very act, it seems, and brought her to Jesus to hear what he would say about the matter. You know, they were always trying to catch him, always trying to trap him, you know, with the law in quote. And number one, they didn't bring the guy who was with her.
Yes.
Notice that. They just brought the woman. Yes. They didn't bring the guy. And some theologians say that one of them was the guy, you know. The very same law guys, Pharisees, were probably one of the guys, you know. Anyhow, they bring this woman who was caught in the act of adultery to Jesus and throw her in front of Jesus to see what he would say. And if you remember, you know, the story goes like that. And he says, anybody who's without sin, let him throw the first stone. And they were ready to stone her, you know, they came with stones and ready to pelt her. And the Bible says, after he made that statement, any of you who is without sin, throw the first stone,
yes.
Cast the first stone. The Bible says that they began to drop their stones one by one, from the oldest to the youngest, you know. And eventually, Jesus looked at the lady and said, where are your offenders? Or where are the people that accused you, you know? And guess what? She said, there's none of them around. And then he said, I don't accuse you either. I do not condemn you either. I do not put guilt on you like that. But go and sin no more.
Amen.
Amen. So notice that Jesus brought the woman up from that place of drop down to death, you know, given up to a place of, I forgive you, go and sin no more. You know, but what I want you to notice here is that women have been treated second class, sometimes like animals, in most cultures and most religious thinking across the globe.
Yes.
And Jesus is the only one who brought women up to their true stature.
Amen.
You know, Jesus was born of a woman, of a virgin. That is a miracle. But he came through the womb of a woman, and he respects women, and he created women. You know, and you know, he treats them the right way. He gives them the right honor. You know, he did not, in the creation account in Genesis, the Bible says that the woman was created out of the rib of the man, not from the head or from, you know, the feet, meaning not to dominate the man and not to be under the feet of the man, but to be at his side, you know, as heirs together. So I thank God that the accusers of that woman, they left one by one, but they left in a certain way. The oldest dropped their stones first. The younger ones still held on to their stones for more time because they felt that they were still justified.
Yeah.
The older guys felt, we've sinned quite a bit, so I have nothing to say, you know. But even to the young people, Jesus says that he's the Lamb who washes away sin. He says we were born in sin, that all of us have sinned, not necessarily because of our personal sin, but because of our ancestors and our forefathers, all the way down to Adam, who's supposed to be our great forefather. And because he sinned, all of us have sinned. And therefore, this fall in the nature and self became prominent and self became the ruler of everything.
Yes.
But Jesus came, took away our sin, took away our curse, and says, I'm not accusing you anymore, but go and sin no more. I forgive you, I let you go, go and sin no more. So it's possible to live in a place where you don't sin like that,
yes.
where you're living forgiven and you're living a righteous life, enjoying more and more a pure life, living like Him more and
yes.
more, you know. And I thank God that it's actually happening and
Amen.
It can be done,
Amen.
You know. So no matter what you've been through, no matter what your situation has been, the honor that Jesus has for you is you are special and He forgives you and He says, go and sin no more. I will help you to go and live a good life where you are not captive to anything,
Amen.
You know. And I thank God for that. So when it comes to the honor of God for women, maybe you have a thought or two from that side, because you're a woman. You know, I remember you discussing one time that from your kind of background, at a certain time of the month, women were not allowed to approach holy places. You know, and that was a question for you.
Yeah.
If God is everywhere, you know, can you remind me of that?
Yeah. Well, from my background, when the girl goes through her monthly cycles, she is not allowed to go near the place of worship. So one of the questions that was in my mind was at that point, if God was omnipresent, which we believed even then, how can we hide or keep ourselves from God? You know, so we felt that was a separation, a different law for men and different law for women. But in Christ, 24/7, we can approach Him boldly to the throne of grace.
Amen.
You know, we have access to the throne of the Father anytime, any situation, whether you have your monthly cycles or not, or whatever it is, He lives in me.
Amen.
As a born-again child of God, I am His temple.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the greatest honor. He says that He's dwelling in me, that I'm inseparable from Him. That is the highest honor I can see that He has given me as a woman.
Amen.
You know, it's amazing. It's not like only the men, He lives in them, and then women, no, I'll visit you and, you know, once in a while, no. You know, so
yeah.
I think that is
a
privilege.
Hallelujah.
And now He just tells me, you draw to me, you come, I'm available for you. Anytime you want to come, you come. So I take my opportunity, I take my privilege, I take my position He has given me
Amen.
As His daughter
yeah.
and run to the throne room of my Father
Amen.
To behold the beauty of His holiness,
Hallelujah.
To behold the purity, the love. And, you know, as Pastor said, once He forgives, He forgets. And He says, I don't condemn you, sin no more.
Yeah.
See, this sin is also, you know, the Bible says very clearly, if you look upon a woman, even your thought, if you look upon an adulterous thought, you've committed sin.
Yeah.
That's how pure and holy Jesus is.
That's right.
That's the height of purity and holiness. You
Amen.
Know, so we have to guard our mind. You know, one of the things that helps me, because I love my daddy so much, Jesus, I mean, no one can take His place. I love Him so much. So even if a negative or lustful thoughts that try to come, the first thing I address it is said, I love righteousness and I hate iniquity.
Amen.
And why I hate iniquity is because sin tries to separate me from my Father.
Yeah.
It tries to keep me from the fellowship I have with my Father. So that is number one for me. This honor He's given me, made me sit on His own throne. Jesus has lifted me up from the mud and miry clay and made me sit on His throne, given me this honor and privilege that I can talk to Father God face to face. And I'm not going to let any thought, sinful thought, to enter my head or entertain it, because the love and the honor my Father has given me.
Amen.
That's a very high level of honor, I would say that.
That's right. You know, over there in Romans 8 verse 17, I believe it says that we're heirs together,
Amen.
You know, with Christ,
yes.
and we're joint heirs with Him.
Amen.
That's how it is even in marriage, you
Amen.
Know, husband and wife are sharing the grace of life
Amen.
Together.
Amen.
You know, so I know that I've seen, you know, I'm sure you have seen too, how people say this is my money, your money, and all that stuff,
our
you
money.
Know, you know, our money. So, maybe you have some thoughts on those things, you know.
My money is mine, your money is mine. That's a thought.
It's not a bad thought.
More than conquerors.
That's why the wife is more than a conqueror.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I mean, Pastor, like, you know, you always used to teach us about this verse. Like, one of the key qualification for marriage is, you know, to leave and to cleave.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes we just, you know, say, okay, living separately. But it is actually, you are a unit together.
Yes.
And you are, a, you know, in partnership.
Yes.
There is no more two.
Yes.
It's actually one.
Yeah.
So it's like something like, you know, Jesus, you know, brought us into, you know, that commonwealth of Israel.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So we all have access. It's not like only the Jews have the access. No, now we are new creatures.
Yes.
We have been brought onto that table. The same way, you know, it's like a joint heirship.
Yeah.
So we can't say, okay, this is mine and this is yours.
Yes, yes.
I mean, it doesn't work there.
Yeah.
You know, in a Christian marriage, in a godly marriage,
yeah.
or in the marriage which God instituted.
Yeah.
You know, that's where you started it from.
Yeah.
Where God instituted, because this is, marriage is not man's idea.
Yeah.
It and before Adam and Eve could even have, you know, parents, God said, you will leave your father and mother. So it's more than, you know, something that is happening in the inside of a man,
yeah.
rather than just outside.
That's right.
And inside, you are being joined yeah. as we agree more and more on these truths.
That's right.
So I can't have a godly marriage or experience heaven in my marriage if I am thinking apart from my wife.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
I have to now, we have to learn or train ourselves to think together.
Yeah.
And we have to give our space.
Yeah.
We have to give our, we must understand that, you know, we both are individuals in God.
Yes.
You know, we all, both are uniques. I'm not competing with my wife and my wife is not competing with me,
yes.
because it will be an insult to God to say that we are saying equal.
Yes. Yes.
And so God has created all of us unique.
Yeah.
So in that uniqueness, I need to find, and I need to find that common place,
yeah.
and bring out that, you know, thing, and that'd be beautiful.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So I can't just, you know, in my life think separately.
Yeah.
So there is nothing like that, you know.
Yeah.
So we must have a common thing.
Yeah.
Everything, you know, we discuss, and I should, and we should always be able to talk, and we should be always be able to, you know, communicate together.
Amen.
Because, like you said, with the, you know, with that story about, you know, the woman being about to stone, people left with their conscience, you
yeah.
know,
yeah.
and that is what it is. You know, we have come with various traditions,
yeah.
which has so affected our conscience,
yes, right.
that we look at women so down.
That's right.
And that maybe it has been instilled into you from your forefathers.
That's right. That's right.
And it has come from, actually from the devil.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you have been brought up and say, this is a man's job. And this is a woman's job.
That's right.
And so I don't have a problem in cleaning toilets.
That's
yeah.
right.
Yeah.
And I do better.
Yeah.
So
yes.
I take that place.
Yes. Amen.
So, you know, so in that, you know, union thing,
yeah.
we find our place,
yes.
and we find our gift and,
yes.
and our edge.
Yes.
And we should not be saying, okay, I am a man, so I can't cook. Because
mm-hmm.
we come from a tradition. They say, what are you men doing in the kitchen?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That's right.
So it's a woman's job.
Yeah.
So God didn't define this mm-hmm. is woman's job. Or
yeah. no.
Because Jesus broiled the fish.
I like that. Jesus broiled the fish. Yeah. I mean, I was just thinking as you were sharing,
yeah.
you know, about the financial part.
Yes.
You know, we discuss about everything. Some women out there may have this thought.
Yeah. yeah.
Do you mean every single thing I have to discuss and ask my husband if I want to buy a dress? Oh, I have to ask my husband. Or if I want to buy a lipstick, do I have to ask my husband? Don't I have little money for myself to do what I want?
Yeah.
So I would like, you know, Pastor Michael, to how do you, yeah. You know, handle that with me in this matter?
Yeah, well, as time has passed, I realized that Jesus, as the, you know, bridegroom, treated the church in a certain way,
Amen.
And that's the ideal.
Amen.
And I found out that what Jesus did was he practically gave everything he had to the church. He laid down his life and gave everything. So I found out that that's the ideal. Now, you may look like a fool if you do that, where you just give everything to your wife. But I found out that if Jesus did it, it's not foolish. It may look foolish, but it's the wisdom of God.
Amen.
You are doing it because Jesus did it. So what I have done is I've tried to make sure my wife is more well-to-do or more wealthy than I am.
Amen.
Constantly, I make sure she has her own account and I try to make sure she has more money than I have, because I saw some things in the scripture which I think I should read from Peter, 1 Peter chapter 3, and it says there in the 7th verse, you know, I like to quote Peter because in these respects, because Peter was married. Paul was never married according to the Bible as far as we know. But Peter was married, and we know that Jesus healed his mother-in-law, you know. Yeah, it's written there. So notice it says, likewise, you husbands, dwell with them or with your wives according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel. Yes. Notice that, as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Amen. So there is a fact there, right? Off the bat, you can see that God sees a husband and wife relationship to be so important to Him. Amen. That if you're fighting with your wife, don't even waste time praying.
Yes.
He says your prayers won't be answered. That is why I needed to fix things, you know. I needed to make sure that my wife was happy. Because, you know, whether we like it or not, that girl that you're accepting as a believer is actually the daughter of the one you're praying to.
Yes.
So you better be careful how you treat her, right? But then you say, what about me? You don't bother about that. You do what you're supposed to do, and God will handle your stuff, your aspect, yes. You know? And He says, treat them as though they're weak, as yes. though they're the weaker vessel. But I don't think they're that weak.
Yeah.
Because I don't think they're men who can have children.
Yeah.
Try and have a child and see if you can.
Sometimes
you know, try
they carry more than men.
Yeah, they carry more. I came from Africa, and in Africa there were women who would be carrying babies on the back, and one baby on the breast, and another one there, and carrying the, you know, farm produce coming from the farm, while the husband is sitting under a tree drinking up and smoking. She does everything. She feeds the house, she cooks, she cleans, she takes care of everything. And you want to say she's weak? I don't think she's physically weak, in quotes. I think she may have emotional weaknesses due to the way the cycles and the hormones and all those things. And so we treat them with respect in that aspect. You know, we know they have such weaknesses. So you make sure that you can comfort them, strengthen them, let them know that you are there for them, give them money, give them that liberty to know that you care for them, you know. And any sane woman, you know, thank God for sane women, any sane woman should know by that kind of treatment, this man will do anything for me.
Yes.
And so I'm going to treat him right.
Amen.
You don't find such men around,
Amen.
You know, and so I'm going to be good to this man.
Amen.
Most sane women.
Amen.
I don't know about the insane ones, but thank God for I thank God for the sane women. So that's, you know, what I believe. And as long as you work with the Word of God and what, you know, Jesus says, it's perfect.
Amen.
It'll always come back, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. You know, it comes back to you. I believe that seriously. And it goes down to the bedroom too.
Yes.
You know, the Bible says that a husband and a wife must give their bodies to each other.
Yes.
As and when each desires.
Yes.
Because your body belongs to your wife, and her body belongs to the husband.
Amen.
And the only time when they should separate themselves is for prayer and fasting, and that too by mutual consent. You will find that in 1 Corinthians 7. You know, so there must be agreement about these things, and there's a lot that goes on in that sleeping with each other, you know, in the love of God. There's amazing things that happen there which God knows about. And guess what? Children get born in that setup.
Amen.
While you are pleasing each other and
yes.
giving to each other, the product is a child. It's like you have created something new.
Amen.
It's amazing, you know.
Amazing.
So, and God wants you to continue, not just for having children's sake, but for pleasure.
Amen.
You know, I quote Abraham now and then, you know, Abraham and Sarah, or Sarah, or Sarah, you know what? The Jewish names are, but Sarah said at 90, you know, who would have said that I would have pleasure with my husband?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's all right to have pleasure with your
yes.
husband. Amen. God created it.
Amen.
And you're supposed to enjoy each other,
yes.
you know, and that's honoring her,
yes.
bringing her close to you and,
Amen.
You know, enjoying that communion with her. So God has worked these things out. Yes. Not that after that you just kick her and treat her like trash and, you know, put her under the table. And no, that's not God.
Yeah.
That's not Bible. That's not New Covenant,
yeah.
You know. And thank God for the New Covenant,
yes.
You know. Would you like to add anything to these thoughts?
Yes, I mean, that's very true. The Bible, you know, says that, you know, the body of the wife belongs to the husband.
Amen.
And the body of the husband belongs to the wife.
Yeah.
And I've heard of some women, you know, who have complained that the husband wants them, you know, almost every day.
Hmm.
I've told them, you should be happy because he's not going after another woman. He wants you. He desires you.
Amen.
I mean, as long as your husband wants you, be ready. I mean, be ready for your husband every day as though it's your first night.
Amen.
You know, that's my advice.
Amen.
Prepare yourself as though it's the first time, first night you got married. How, you know, you would prepare yourself. Take time. It doesn't matter. I mean, now I'm going to be 48 years old next month. But still, you know, my husband loves me. I know that. He tells me, you're fine the way you are, you know. He doesn't want me to become skinny or anything like that. I tried losing a lot of weight some time ago. He said, no, that's too much. Just hang in there, you know. So that's between you and your spouse,
yeah.
You know. And but for a wife, approach each night as though it is your first night. Prepare yourself. Have a nice bath. Put on some nice cream or oil. You know, you don't have to invest in something so expensive. Something simple. But prepare yourself for your husband.
Amen.
And anytime he wants me, I'm there.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, I'm sure you would have some things to say about that. You know, but in as we approach these issues, you know, it says there in the scripture that I believe is in 1 Corinthians 11, probably in the 16th verse or so, it says that the woman is the glory of the man.
Amen.
You know, so if the woman is looking good, that means the husband is doing a good job.
Amen.
That is the glory of the husband.
Yes.
You see?
Amen.
What would you like to add to that?
You know, I will go back and read that, you know, 1 Peter
yeah.
chapter 3,
yes.
because it's just there.
Yeah.
You know, it says, but let it be the hidden man of the heart,
Amen.
In that which is not corruptible,
yes.
the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit,
yes.
which is in the sight of God.
Yeah.
Of great price.
Yes.
Amen. So the true beauty
yeah.
is inside us.
That's right.
Amen. The true work of Christ is actually happened inside.
Yes.
Mm.
So if you don't accept it or not, we are beautiful inside.
That's
right. Yes.
It's just that our thinking, our emotions, and you know, has to affect and be reflecting this beauty.
Yes.
So especially in marriage, a woman can be so beautiful inside.
Yeah.
I'm not saying you should neglect the outside and don't wear lipstick and be a daughter, you know, you're daughters of the king.
Yes.
And you know, and so we need to present ourselves, you know, as how a queen or daughter of a king should be.
Yes.
Right.
Amen.
Yes.
And moreover, you should present yourself how your husband likes it.
That's yeah. right. That's
Amen.
The key. Yeah.
So it's not like, you know, I'm my dressing should impress my wife.
Yes. Yes.
And my wife's, you know, dressing should impress me.
Yes.
And we should be able to free to talk to each other about
mm-hmm.
it.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So that beauty from the inside should come out.
Yeah.
Amen. And if we could spend time focusing and building that up, and that comes by, you know, looking at the mirror of the Word.
Mm.
And understanding, like you said, you know, that when we look at the Word and when we hear it, it is like, you know, a picture is formed.
Yeah.
Mm. Amen. And but when you start acting on it, you know, that picture is now created outside.
Yes. Yes.
Otherwise, it's just inside. Nobody knows what is inside you. Amen. But for that picture to come out, you have to act it.
Yes.
Amen. And you have to say, you know, so some of the things which I say in marriage, because see, many times we say things for finances, we say things for, you know, health and this, but we also need to say things for your marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. So I say, I desire my wife more than anybody else.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. I love her and she excites me.
Yes. Mm. Yes.
So this is, you know, I speak it. It's not that I just started speaking. I've been speaking from the time we got married, you know.
Yes.
And you know, and there is a verse in Job. So You need to take the verse and apply it to yourself, mm-hmm. you know. So he said, when I look at a woman, you know, I say, you know, it doesn't lust after her.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my heart will not follow after my eyes.
Yes.
My eyes will follow after the covenant of God,
Amen.
Which I made with my wife
Amen.
In front of him.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So these things keep me
Amen.
And help me to bring the beauty inside.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
And when you speak that over your wife, you know, that true beauty comes out. So
yes.
I remember one time when Pastor was speaching in, you know, in Bible study when we were in Harsha Hotel,
yeah.
You know, so he was saying about, you know, there are gems, you know, women are like, you know, precious gems,
yeah.
you know, sometimes, you know, they are uncut,
yeah.
you know, so, but the gem is inside,
yes.
you know, so you take and you speak and you work with your wife. So it's the husband's job to do that,
mm-hmm.
you know, that we speak
yeah.
that and they see that value, they see that they are actually, you know, so precious
mm-hmm.
And about that God has made them a special.
Yes.
Amen.
I really believe that's powerful stuff there, you know. That was the seventh verse over there in 1 Corinthians 11. He says about covering the head and all that, some traditions, but he says that, but the woman is the glory of the man, you know.
Amen.
So don't forget that. If you get married, your wife is your glory,
Amen.
You know. And so Solomon, the Bible says that Solomon in all of his glory was not as glorious as a flower.
Hallelujah.
You know, so it's talking about his dressing and his wealth and all that. And now imagine if the wife is the glory of the man. If your wife is looking beautiful and taken care of and satisfied and happy,
Amen.
That speaks about your glory. That's how glorious you are.
Amen.
You know, so if we begin to treat our wives like they are our glory or our wealth
Amen.
Or our clothing
Hallelujah.
Or our splendor or our shining, everything changes,
yes.
you know. And the Bible says that if you love your wife, you are loving yourself.
Amen.
You're not actually hating yourself. You are loving your own body because your wife is your own flesh.
Hallelujah.
You know, so you're treating your own flesh well. And as you grow older, most people will leave you the older you get.
Yeah.
But guess what? Because you've been investing honor and value into your wife, she'll be there with you.
Amen.
She will take care of you when there's nobody else.
Amen.
You know, these are the truths that eventually God's word will back you up.
Hallelujah.
And, you know, you will reap the benefit of it. And I believe that, you know, we will not grow old and wrinkle up like that, you know, like a,
like a prune.
like a prune. I really believe that we will be renewed and
yes.
strengthened and
Amen.
We will still ride bikes
yes.
when we are in our 70s
yes.
and, you know, we will still travel the globe and
Amen.
Enjoy one another and people will want to hear and watch our lives even at that age.
Yes.
Amen. So I'm just speaking because I believe that is God's will and is God's word and it'll bless humanity
Amen.
And raise the level of our living and our blessing, you know, to the next place in God,
Amen.
You know. So praise God. He's a faithful God. He's a loving Heavenly Father. And if you've been through a divorce and if you've been through a tough marriage, there's always another chance. There's always another day. God is the God of another chance. But you can do it with the word. You can do it in Him. You can surrender your life to Him and let Him pick you up. He's the God who raises the dead.
Amen.
That means there's no situation that is dead that He will not lift up. No matter what you've been through, if you take your hands and put your hands into His hands and believe the word with Him, He'll take you through. He can make you a success. No matter what your marriage has been like, your relationship has been like, He can turn things around. But there is work. You know, solpa kelsaide. You know, there's work to do. There's work to do. And if you're willing to do that work,
yeah.
you can have days of heaven on earth.
Amen.
I mean, our days are better than when we first started.
Hallelujah.
There's no doubt about
Amen.
That. We are now getting ready to see our children having their children.
Amen.
We are, you know, at that kind of a place. And we're waiting patiently
Amen.
To be that. So, I believe that God is working mightily in your marriages, in your relationships. Don't give up. Jesus is waiting for your call. You call on Him from a sincere heart. No matter what you've been through, He will bring you out. He will make you have success and victory in everything you do. I thank God that we can pray. Shall we just pray for a minute? Father, in Jesus' name, whoever is watching, whoever is listening, may the grace of God reach them in their marriage, in their situation, in their circumstance. Let the blessing of the Lord that makes rich and has no sorrow come into their situation. Let them make a commitment. Lord, I thank you that you will turn things around for them. If their marriage has ended in divorce and they want to go and live again and enjoy marriage again, Lord, I pray that you speak to their hearts, that they commit their life to you, commit their life to the Word of God, and find the blessing and find the victory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you so much for listening in. Thank you for responding. Thank you for staying in touch. Thank you.